Revelation Church. Make some noise. Come on, let me know you're awake. Come on. Woo! All right, all right, all right, all right. My favorite day of the week is Sunday. We're glad you're here. Thanks for coming back to be a part of this message series called Disaster Relief. If you're brand new to the church world and you don't know what this means, we just pick a topic and we just talk about it until everybody's sick and tired of it. That's not true, okay? We actually give you stuff that's real, relatable, and relevant to your life. So what we're doing is we're in this message series called Disaster Relief, and the idea is to address some areas of our life that can cause us to have a natural disaster if we don't get ahead of the game on it. If we don't start talking about it to learn how to identify the problem before it happens, we're going to run into it, and it's going to destroy our lives. And so the way we talk about it in week one, we had this series, and we started with the idea of lust and pornography as the top kickoff of the series. We need to address that issue because it's destroying marriages all across the country. Then we talked in week two about gossip and negativity, and then we talked in week three about greed, jealousy, and selfishness. And I want to go ahead and set up next week's message because I think it's going to be really impactful. We're going to talk about the idea of bitterness and unforgiveness. Bitterness and unforgiveness. And I think with the holidays just wrapping up with Thanksgiving, y'all seen some family, y'all had some issues, and we're going to need to talk about this bitterness and unforgiveness thing because I think it's important for our future. Today, though, what we're going to do is we're going to discuss this topic of anxiety and depression. And our slogan is we want to give you stuff that's real, relatable, and relevant because at the end of the day, here's what I know. On Monday morning, I want you to go into work or do whatever that you're going to do, whether it's school, work, life, and I want you to realize that what we talked about on Sunday is important for your life. We don't want to be a church that tells you something on Sunday and you go, I don't even know what I'm supposed to do with that preacher. What's the point of even knowing any of that? And so as we go into addressing all this, I want to talk about the idea, first off, of being overwhelmed. Being overwhelmed, because the truth is, we all get overwhelmed. You don't even have to be a Christian to go, I get overwhelmed. You can at least give me that. Even if you're not a believer, you go, yeah, there's seasons and times in my life where I get overwhelmed. Think about the different areas of people's life. If you're a student, you're probably either just getting done being overwhelmed with some exams, or you got exams coming up in the next few weeks right before Christmas break, and you're freaking out right now, and you're thinking to myself, how am I going to get through this? What are we going to do? This exam, and you've been praying, religiously that Jesus would come back so you don't have to take your final exam, right? You've been seriously God, just anything to keep me because I'm not ready, right? And you get overwhelmed. If you're newly married, we know the stresses and the overwhelmness that comes with being newly married. Or if you're engaged, planning a wedding can be a very overwhelming time in a person's life. Our youth pastor, Chris, is getting married to Alex in January, and it's awesome to see him week to week and day to day at work because he, stresses out about everything right now. He's super stressed. He's heightened. And so I like messing with Chris, but it's an overwhelming time. If you've been married for a while and you are going to have your first kid, doesn't matter what anybody tells you, you're not going to sleep for a year, and there's nothing you can do about it, right? It's amazing. It's just this is what happens. It's part of life. Having your kids leave the house, even though that's the goal, is to get them to leave the house eventually, right? That can be overwhelming because it's an emotional time and you're like, what's going to happen? How about paying for college? Paying for college. You get that big bill in the mail and that big old number and you're just like, oh, this is ridiculous how much money we owe. And it's overwhelming. You don't even want to think about it. Now, all those things are life things that are going to happen, right? That stuff's going to happen. Life's going to happen. There's going to be issues. There's going to be problems. I'm not talking about a person just getting overwhelmed on occasion or having, just a problem one time, the occasional thing. I'm talking about when a season turns into a sickness. There's a difference between having a problem and going through a season of something, but the season actually turning into a sickness. I want to talk about how to deal with that today because I believe there's some people right here amongst us that quite honestly, you're very sick. And I don't say that as a spirit of condemnation by any means. I say it as a spirit of let's have a conversation today about what's really going on. Because truth be told, today as we talk about fear, anxiety, as we talk about depression, as we talk about suicidal thoughts, I think there's a lot of people in this room that are dealing with that. And that's not God's best for your life, and that's not God's plan for your life. So because of that, I want to kick it off the way that Pastor Randy would, with some funny clips, okay? Because we got to have some funny clips. We're going to talk about a very serious topic. Let's at least laugh about a couple things to get our minds right, because I think there's a lot of people that struggle with this, but because of pride, they don't want to admit that they have a problem. And so since they don't admit they have a problem, they never get the help that they need. And I'm convinced that we need spotters in our life. What is a spotter? A spotter is a person when you're in the gym and you're benching and you're lifting that weight and it's really heavy, they're there to make sure that the thing doesn't drop on you and kill you. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Watch this funny clip to get our minds right. Clips like that. I love watching, like, I'll be busy and doing something. Amy's like, "You're so preoccupied. What are you doing?" I'm like, "I'm working on important stuff right now, and I'm watching clips like this," right? It's just what, it's part of life. But I started thinking about it. I'm like, this is a lot of people in the church world. A lot of people in the church world, they go through unnecessary pain and unnecessary issues and unnecessary problems, and they do it alone without a spotter. And the spotter's not there to lift all the weight off. They're there to simply guide and make sure that if there is a problem, that, hey, there's someone here to help you. And about once a year, I preach a message specifically attacking this idea of depression, anxiety, fear, and suicidal thoughts. And I do it every year because I think it's important. I think there's a lot of people that I love in this church that battle this kind of stuff. And if we don't ever talk about it, and if you never come and you hear this type of message, you're never going to experience the life change that God wants to offer you in this life. At this church, our church is a lot different than a lot of other churches. A lot of churches don't address these kind of topics. They don't talk about them. There's a lot of other issues in the Bible, a lot of other things in the Bible you can talk about. So a lot of people, and I'm not dogging anybody, but they'll talk about all the sugar-coated stuff, all the stuff that makes people feel good. Quite honestly, there's some people today, you're here and you had no clue we were going to start talking about fear, anxiety, depression, and suicide today. And you're just bothered by this already because you were thinking, hey, I'm going to come to church and, you know, I'm just going to have a good time. I'm going to worship the Lord and I'm going to be here and everything's going to be good. And then I'm going to leave. I'm going to be here for about an hour. Life is good. It'll be okay. And then all of a sudden I start bringing all this up and I'm almost putting you in a position where you're going to have to face some of the issues that you're really going with. And there's this battle that's going on in your head and in your heart. Now, it doesn't mean that you don't want to find freedom. It's just a lot of people, when it comes to these kind of topics, we go, I'm not ready to talk about that, or I'm not ready to deal with that. And I just wonder how often we're not okay and we don't get the help that we need. At this church is a lot different than a lot of other places. It's okay in this place to not be okay. It's okay to not be okay. I want you to know that from the bottom of my heart. We want you to come as you are. We want you to come with all your junk, all your issue, all your mess. It's okay to not be okay. You don't have to clean your whole life up in order to come to church. Somebody give me an amen.
Amen.
Okay? You don't have to clean up your whole life in order to come to God, because God meets you right where you are, however messy it is. By the way, he can handle all that junk. Okay? He's not intimidated by, oh man, you're so mad. You better go clean up before you come to me. No. He's like, come here. Ooh, that's a good one. Come here, right? He's ready to do something in your life, and he can work through all that. It's okay to not be okay, but listen to me, church. Everybody lean in. It's not okay to stay that way. Amen. It's not okay to stay that way. And the reason I say that is because our church is welcoming of anybody and everybody, no matter what your past is, no matter what you're going through, God has a plan for your life. But a lot of people, they'll use what Pastor Randy said, and they'll use that first part to justify sin in their life. Well, Pastor Randy said it's okay to not be okay, so I can just keep doing this. No. There's not a period there. There's a comma. It's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay that way. We want you to move beyond the mess and find freedom in your life. Today, we're going to read out of the scripture in the New Testament, out of the book of James. If you have your Bible, go to James chapter 5. James chapter 5. James is five chapters long. Okay, it's only five chapters long. Probably take you less than 25, 30 minutes to read through the whole book of James. Now, little known things about James is the brother of Jesus. And it's interesting because a lot of scholars believe it's the oldest book in the New Testament. And we know that Jesus is the real deal because James, the brother of Jesus, even believed that he was the Son of God. Real quick, how many of you in the room, you have a brother? Put your hands here. You have your brother. Okay, you have a brother. How many of you believe that your brother, let me say it differently. What would it take for you to believe that your brother is the Son of God? Think about that for a second. Think about your brother, okay? Maybe the son of Satan, but not the Son of God, right? Like far from the Son of God. But James actually believed that Jesus was who he said he was because he had watched him die and 3 days later raised back to life. Now, if you needed some proof, if your brother did that, you'd say, hey, that'll at least put us on the right path, right? Like this is a big deal. So James, he identifies that, yeah, Jesus is the real deal. He came back to life. And then this book that he wrote, five chapters long, is packed with a ton of useful information for every single person in the room. Today, what I want to focus on is three simple verses out of the book of James that I believe have the power to break us and heal us from fear, anxiety, depression, and suicidal thoughts. James chapter 5, starting in verse 14, it says this. Is anyone among you sick? Now, I think there's a lot of sickness going around in the church. Is anyone among you sick? It says, let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil. Now, I want to stop real quick because if you're from a church background or even from a non-church background, you get this, right? Like if somebody's sick, we pray for them. Somebody gets sick at your workplace, oh, I'm praying for them. If you got a cold, hey, pray for me. Okay, yeah, you got a cold, I'll pray for you. We've had people call and say, hey, I was diagnosed with cancer. Can we get somebody from the church to pray with us? It's always yes and amen. We want to be there. We want to help however we can. Hey, my father's in the hospital. Can I get somebody to pray with us? Yeah, absolutely. We want to send a team of people to go pray over people. Seems like, though, that we've always limited this verse to a physical sickness. But I think James meant much more than just a physical sickness. I think he was talking about whenever we have mental sickness as well. So I have a little chart I want to share with you. This isn't like a scientific chart. This isn't ADA, you know, HDA, DA, 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 whatever, approved. This is Pastor Randy lived some life and went through some stuff and identified a problem and noticed some things, and I want to share it with you today. Can I do that? Say yes?
Yes.
Okay, and then what happened was I started meeting a lot of people within the church that had problems, and they'd come in for counseling, and then I go, wow, their chart looks like my chart. Wow, interesting. And then I go, maybe I need to go get this ADHD AAA thing approved, right? Don't even know what I'm trying to get approved. But I can tell you this, there are seasons in my life where I'm doing great. There are seasons in my life where I'm just doing good. There are seasons in my life where fear begins to creep in on something that's going on. I think this is where a lot of people, you can go, yeah, something in your mind that you're just, it's just bothering you. You're a little fearful of what's going to happen with that. And then anxiety begins to take over. And that's when it moves from just like, hey, I'm thinking about it, into every time I think about it, something within me is changing. Something within me is just stirred up, and I don't know what to do with it. And it almost feels like it's too much. And then what happens is we move from anxiety into depression. And depression is, let me explain that for a few seconds. Depression is whenever you wake up and you have a lot to do on the agenda, but you don't feel like doing anything. And it's not that you're being lazy, because mentally you're ready to rock and roll. Mentally you're like, let's get up and go. But then another side of you is like, no, mentally I don't want to get up and move and do anything. It's both at the same time. It's I can do it. Yeah, let's get up. And then no, I can't do it. No, I don't want to do it. No, I don't feel good. You don't feel good and you don't even know why you don't feel good. You just don't feel good. You're lethargic. You don't want to get up and go anywhere. You don't want to be around anybody. You don't want to talk to anybody. Depression is where you know what to do, but you can't, you seem paralyzed. It's like you can't get up and get going to do it. depression. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm saying? Okay, I'm not the only one in the room. Good, 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 good. Actually, not good, not good, not good, not good, not good. Right? We're going to help with that. Okay? And then depression can lead to suicidal thoughts. And here's what I found. Worry undealt with leads to anxiety. Anxiety undealt with leads to depression. Depression undealt with leads to suicidal thoughts. And suicidal thoughts undealt with will lead to suicide. You've seen it and I've seen it. And I want you to know that if you're anywhere on that chart besides in good or great, you're sick right now, dude. And it might just be a little cough, but if you don't deal with that little cough, it's going to turn to something bigger. And if you don't deal with that, it's going to be even bigger. And if you don't deal with that, it's going to take your life. And I'm just convinced that people matter so much to the heart of God that we got to be willing to do whatever it takes to connect them to Him. And part of our church being willing to do whatever it takes is to address all the issues that nobody wants to talk about. Long story short, I'm going to go down memory lane here. Once a year I share this because I believe it's important. But when I was 16 years old, I got arrested for shoplifting. Got arrested. That was not a good day. Police put me in handcuffs, put me in the back of the car, ushered me out, took me down to the jail. It was a horrible, horrible time in my life. 16 years old, I went to a school, funny enough, that had metal detectors and dogs that sniff you when you walk in. I grew up outside of Cincinnati area in a pretty rough area. The crime on that, when you look up on like the rate of like what's a real bad city to live in and a real good one, we're like the top like in that area. We didn't know though, we lived there and we grew up in it and just was what it was, but I lived in a little rough area. I remember going through the court process, going through all that. That was a devastating time in my life. Didn't start off real great there as a teenager, right? That was not the best way to do it. Got my license and got myself in trouble. After some repentance, God got a hold of my heart, and then I kind of developed what I would say is a works-based mentality to church world. And I think a lot of church people have this works-based mentality. I need to work harder, I need to do more, I need to be this, I need to be that, and if I'm not measuring up, then God somehow doesn't love me or something like that. And even though logically we know that God loves us no matter what, there was just this idea that I have to work hard, I have to do more. Well, my mentality in life has always been, I don't have time to deal with all that nonsense. So I had a little bit of worry that was coming up as I started the church. And I'm a man, so I'm like, I got places to go, I got people to see, I've got appointments to get to. I don't got time to deal with this worry from way back here. And you know what? That worry led to anxiety. Because stuff from my past, even whenever I was a teenager, started creeping up again. Not shoplifting, none of that stuff. What it was the devil reminding me of my past. And saying, who are you to get up there and stand before anybody? What qualifies you to be able to tell anybody anything? Satan is really good, by the way, about reminding you of your past. Somebody give me an amen. Amen. Can I get a real amen? Amen? All right, thank you, thank you, thank you. Because at the end of the day, here's what I learned through that. Any time that Satan reminds you of your past, you just need to remind him of his future. Okay? That's what you need to learn to do. It'll change the way that you operate. You just remind him. Listen, but I learned a long time ago that if I don't deal with this anxiety, it leads me to depression. And that's what happened. I literally was depressed as the pastor of this church for about a year and a half. About a year and a half, just horrible depression. Didn't want to go anywhere, just wanted to sleep, didn't want to talk to anybody. In fact, some of you, very few of you at this stage would remember, I had my first panic attack while I was preaching on stage. I got up to give a message, it was the first service, it was actually in the other building, and I got up and I couldn't even talk. I just started crying. And I cried for like, I don't know how long. Weirdest Sunday of all time. Like just crazy, crazy stuff. I had all this pressure in that season. I had people talking negatively and had people causing trouble and pain in the church. I had some heartbreaking family issues. We were struggling in our marriage because guess what? When it rains, it pours. Because your pastor is not exempt from the same struggles that you struggle with. Just a regular person just like you. And at the end of the day, when things got even worse, we were on our way to Dallas, and as we're down there and we come over this hill, we slowed down because there was this big line of cars trying to get off the exit, and a semi came at 70 miles an hour over that hill and slammed into us, and we hit about six or seven other cars, And I remember I blacked out. I don't know what happened all the way. But I remember waking up to sirens and ambulances and my body burning because the airbag had deployed. And if you've ever had that happen, you know what that feels like. And I remember seeing shattered glass everywhere. And I remember seeing car seats up in the front seat. And I remember waking up going, where am I and what just happened? Literally almost lost my life. So here we are talking today. And I'm telling you that when I talk to you about depression, I don't speak from a place of looking up in the dictionary definition what the word depression means. I come to you and I speak to you from a place of experiencing true depression. It's not something, I used to think like this, and by the way, if this is you, man, let's pray about this one. I used to think, well, we'll just get over it. Just get over it, and you'll be okay. You know how many times I tried to tell myself to just get over it and be okay while I was going through depression? I couldn't get over it and be okay. Well, you weren't tough enough. Dude, come up here and let me hit you in the head as hard as I can and see if I'm pretty tough or not, right? I was tough. I was tough as I could be. Doing everything I had, and I couldn't get over it. I was depressed. Let me tell you where that depression that was left undealt with led. Because it all just leads, it's like a domino effect. It leads to the next thing. I was driving down on Highway 380 over here. I remember coming to a light, and the light was green. And I remember thinking to myself, how great would it be, because I was dealing with all this mess, how great would it be if as I'm going through this green light, the guy didn't stop at the red light, and he just smashed his car right into me, and it killed me. Like, how great would that be? Because then I wouldn't have to deal with all this stuff that's going on. Can I just tell you, that's a really bad, dark spot to be in. It's a really bad, dark place. You know, I went through that light, and the guy obviously didn't hit me and kill me. And I kind of got disappointed. Then I remember driving down that same road, because it was kind of on my route every day. And I drove, and as I was driving, I had a thought again. And every time I went through that light, I had that thought. Then it shifted to, no, why am I worried about somebody else trying to take care of this? Why don't I just take care of this myself? How about I'll just run the light, and the person will come and kill me, and then I can do it myself. Can I just tell you, that is a horrible, horrible, horrible spot to be in, to be thinking that way. Say, is suicide really that big of a deal? Do you know that 16% of Christians have contemplated taking their life? This isn't lost people. These are Christians. 16% of Christians. So if 700 people showed up to church this weekend at Revolution Church, the math on that is 112 people would admit to having thoughts of taking their own life, and that's 112 people too many, if you ask me. Can I get an amen? Amen. Can I get a real amen?
Amen.
Okay. It's not what God wants for you. That's not God's best for your life. Now, I want to park on the suicide thing for a minute because there's some confusion when it comes to the idea of suicide. Well, Randy, if you commit suicide, do you go to hell? And some people, you've been taught that. You had a friend or a family member commit suicide, and you were told that they went to hell. And I want you to listen to me. You don't go to hell because you commit suicide. You go to hell because you don't have a relationship with Jesus, period. Okay? Period. So we don't get to tack on things to this heaven and hell thing, right? Like, you get to go to heaven if, and you don't commit suicide. That's not how it works. The scripture is clear on what gets us to heaven. Suicide, listen, somebody in here in this room, I told you that you don't go to hell if you commit suicide, and you're like relieved. You're like, because that's what I was thinking about doing. Now I'm relieved by it. Listen to me right now. Look at me. Listen, this is important. Suicide is not what God wants for your life. It's not. It's not. See, you think suicide is going to stop the pain. I thought that too. And then here's what I realized, and I've seen this happen over and over again with different people who've actually committed suicide. What really happens is it just spreads the pain to everybody else that's still here. It ends it for you, yeah. And it starts it and spreads it for everybody else. Suicide is not what God wants for your life. Now I want to pick this up in the scripture. And I want to tell you, with everything that I see and believe and the things that I mentioned in this chart, there is sickness, and it's not what God wants for you, but you got to remind yourself, it's okay to not be okay. It's just not okay for us to stay that way. It's okay to feel these feelings in this moment right now, but we need to realize that God has a plan, a mission, and a process that he's wanting to actively work in your life, and perhaps that is the reason why you're here in this moment right now, hearing this message. Perhaps God knows what he's doing. He says this in the scripture, is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them. Basically, if you're sick, if you're dealing with some things, let the church know. Go to the church and ask for help. Basically, James is saying, go put your hand into the air and say, hey, I'm dealing with some things, help me. Now, here's what's funny. I've been around the church world for many, many, many years, and my introduction to the church staff and ministry, quite honestly, was a little bizarre. Okay, it was a little bizarre. I was 18 years old. I got invited to be on staff at a church, and my understanding and mentality of what I thought church staff ministry and working along staff was going to be like was totally different than what it really was. I thought, I'm going to go work with the people of God, and it's going to be smooth sailing from here. And what I learned is that those people are just as messed up and jacked up as we are, as the rest of us, as lost people are. They're so messed up. And I got to work in the church, and I got to see some stuff, and I realized that, you know, James is telling us to tell each other when we have problems, but I realized these are the last people that I would ever want to tell my problems to. Because if they crucified Jesus, who was perfect, they'll definitely crucify me. Your boy's messed up. All right, so this is going to be an issue. And I'm telling you, the way the church world was done as I was growing up and you know, the generations before me, it was very, very messed up. Like, the scripture was twisted in a lot of areas that it just messed a lot of things up. Point in case, you know, you got a little teenage girl who happens to get pregnant. And what was the message that we saw in past generations in church world? You basically tell, listen, all the little teenage girl moms would go up and say, hey, you can't hang out with her anymore. You stay away from her. Almost as if you can catch what that girl had, right? It's like, you can't catch what she had. Do you want me to draw you a picture of how that stuff works? I can do that. But at the end of the day, I don't think that's necessary. This girl doesn't need us to pull away from her. This girl needs biblical community, friendship, and relationship now more than any other time in her life. But the message that she was sent was that you messed up, you screwed up, you're an outcast, you're, you know, the black sheep of the family, so go over here, the redheaded stepchild, right? So boom, over here, and all of a sudden now, you're not welcome. And I just think the church world really got it wrong. Think about it. You're allowed to come to church until the church finds out that you're struggling with an alcohol addiction. I remember people in the church growing up in different churches and seeing the way that this was handled. You see a guy come in, and yeah, he's been drinking, and he looks like he's stumbling around a little bit. I've seen people go walk up to them and usher them out. I've seen that in church. In church. The church is a hospital for sick people to come. And I just want to tell everybody in the room, we're all sick. We're all sick. But at the end of the day, it got so flipped. You're allowed to come to church until they find out that your marriage is on the rocks and you're thinking about divorce. You get excommunicated if you have something like that happen. It's like, wait a second. I thought that nobody was perfect but Jesus. And I thought Jesus wanted to meet us where we are in our mess and help us through our life and help clean our lives up. See, so many people, because of that way that it was taught, we've been conditioned now and conditioned to believe and trained to think we have to clean our whole life up before we can come to God. And God is like, I never said any of that. God can handle you in your mess right where you are today. He doesn't need you to do anything but come to him. That's it. That's it. That's it. Now, the last place you would go to talk about anxiety, suicidal thoughts, depression, any of that is church people, right? I'm going to give you an illustration today that, number one, you're never going to forget. And number two, some of you are going to try to send me an email about and complain that I told you this illustration, okay? But I don't care, and I'm not going to read it, and I don't care, okay? How many of y'all have ever been to, you're never going to forget this illustration. How many of y'all have ever been to somebody's house and you went to use the bathroom after somebody else used the bathroom, and when they were in there, they blew it up? Y'all know what I'm talking about? Like, they blew it up. I'm talking about like grandpa was in the bathroom before you, and it never smells good when grandpa comes out of the bathroom, right? Like something died in there. And there's some women in the room. I don't want to hear this. Can I just tell you, your stuff stinks too, all right? No one's exempt, okay? Send an email to somebody, but I won't even see it. I won't even see it, okay? I've had places where I've gone to the restaurant and that just happened, and I didn't know that that just happened. I walk in there, and you go in there, and you're like, oh, something, like cockroaches are coming out of the wall, surrendering with their hands up. Like, this is horrible, right? And what do you see on the toilet in there? The little Glade air freshener on the top of the toilet where somebody tried to go in there and and you go in there and you're like, dude, it smells like somebody's pooping potpourri up in this place. Like, you still smell it. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Somebody say yes. Can I get an amen?
Yes.
If I can get an amen on that, that's just weird. All right, hey. Here, you say, why are you telling me this? Well, to kind of bring this into a church level, I was thinking about this. I think that's what a lot of people do. I think that's I think that's the way that maybe our weekend church services look to God from the top view. I think what a lot of people are more comfortable with doing, instead of dealing with what's really going on the inside, we just like spraying something to try to mask it and cover up our mess. Because let's be honest, church in America today is all about coming to church for about an hour, hour and a half, putting your good clothes on, okay, putting a smile on your face and acting like you're perfect and you got your whole life together. And if you do all those things and you stand when we stand, you sit when we sit, then you get the little checkbox on your thing. You showed up to church, you did the church thing, and now you're good. That's what church in America has become. And I think God looks down and goes, hey, at the end of the day, you're just trying to mask this and you're only getting temporary relief from the problem. You're never finding true freedom. Never get the real freedom that comes with just letting God do his thing on the inside of us. Because that's what we really need. How do I know that we don't understand this? Well, I know we don't understand it. I'm going to preach this until we get this, by the way. Well, he keeps preaching the same scripture. Yeah, because we don't got it. We'll keep going here because until we get it. He goes in this little rant here in James chapter 5. Call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. So he says, if you got a problem, you tell church people, hey, I've got an issue, I'm dealing with something, and we go pray, and we pray, and we pray. We don't stop praying. The Bible says pray without ceasing. You never stop praying. You pray until you get the desired outcome. You pray in faith. Now, I want to talk about this whole anoint them with oil thing in the name of the Lord. Because people, church people, especially, I know we're a non-denominational church, and this just freaks some of you guys out who are from different church backgrounds, because you're like, the whole oil thing, like, what are they going to do with the oil thing? Like, I'm going to explain what the scripture says, and you get freaked out. But I got a lot of friends in the house today. I got my charismatic friends, and I love celebrating. Listen, yeah, the joy of the Lord with them. They know how to do a worship service. You know, they'll put their hands there and say, God, I give you everything. And listen, some people in the house you got from different backgrounds, you're like, they're putting their hands up over there. Are you seeing that they put their hands up over there? Yeah, they're saying, God, I surrender my life to you. Since when is surrendering our life to God a problem? In 2019, somebody raises their hands and we're over there. We're so distracted on them, we miss actually worshiping the Savior who's here. We're here to do worship to. What are you doing, dude? But I love my charismatic friends. I love my Methodist friends. The Methodist friends, they've led the way with social justice issues better than I think all the other religions. They step in and they've led the way on showing us how to treat people and love people in a different way. And for that, I celebrate with them. My Baptist friends, where are my Baptist people at? Come on, y'all don't raise hands too well here, so give me a nod, give me something, okay? I celebrate a lot of things with my Baptist friends. I grew up Baptist, but one of the things I definitely want to point out is they know how to do the potluck dinner better than anybody else, the lunch better than anybody else, the dinner, the pizza blast, all right? I'm not picking on you. I'm just having fun with everybody in the house. But I say this to say all this, okay? I celebrate all across the board, but my charismatic friends, they love this verse. Oh, they love this verse. Matter of fact, a lot of them, they carry around that little flask of oil in their pocket. They're ready for you, baby. They're ready for you. They've been waiting for you, okay? Because listen, you go up for prayer and you've got a problem and you put your head down to bow in prayer like that, they'll have you in they'll have you anointed before you even knew it. They are ready to rock and roll. And listen, if that's what you do, I would never tell anybody how to pray or not pray, but I'll tell you, I believe in that scripture. I believe that we should pray together. I believe we should anoint each other with oil. I believe the scripture says that. So who is anybody to say we shouldn't do that? The scripture says it right here in James. So what are we talking about, right? But at the end of the day, I think we've gotten so weirded out that we've actually stopped ourselves from receiving what God has. Because at some level, somebody abused it and did something stupid with it, and now we can't even receive what God had for us. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay. If we actually obey the scripture, though, there's something here. There's only three verses I'm sharing, but there's something here that I think changes the game for all of us when it comes to the sickness area of our life. And it changes us. But I've actually studied this, done some research on it. People much smarter than me have been reading the Bible much longer than me. All agreed that this passage right here would be the equivalent to our modern day phrase of take your medicine. That's actually what it means to be anointed with oil. It literally would just be equivalent to take your medicine. Think about that. Which brings up a question. Is taking antidepressants a sin? Do you know some churches teach that that's a sin? And there are people out there that teach that taking an antidepressant is not fully trusting God. My problem with that is if you're going to tell somebody that taking an antidepressant is not trusting God, then you have to tell a diabetic who is taking their insulin that they're not trusting God as well. And I just tell you, that's not real smart. That's not real smart. I mean, there's some people, and you've seen it, well, we're just not going to take any medicine, and we're just going to trust God. Hey, I just want to be real with you. Nobody wants to be that person. Let me explain what I mean by that. What do you mean? Nobody wants to be that person. Because you've seen that person on TV, and they all look the same. They're wearing a denim jumper. They got a doily on their head. They make their own butter, and they live in a cave somewhere. Nobody wants to be that person. Can I get an amen? You ain't going to be that person. Okay, at the end of the day, can we agree? That's like, and by the way, if I just describe your grandma, I am so sorry, but at the end of the day, it's still weird to me, okay? Where am I going with this? Let me go. When I got my first battle with depression, I'm going to tell you, it lasted for several years. And I didn't take any medication at all, and I actually consulted my doctor and told him what was going on. I didn't even tell my wife. I didn't tell anybody what was going on with me. I just told my doctor, hey, here's what's happening. And at that time, we agreed that I didn't need medication at that time. I didn't. And I'm glad that they didn't prescribe medication to me, because at the end of the day, it would have dealt with the fruit of my problem, but not the root of my problem. And I'm so glad that I didn't get some medication to mask something in my life. And God had to bring some stuff to the surface in my life that I had to deal with. Listen, from 20 years ago when I was a teenager, I had to bring some of that junk back up so I could actually deal with it. And then once I dealt with it, I was able to process through. And listen, I wouldn't wish this process on anybody, but God was trying to do something in me without the use of medication at that time. And at that season, I needed that. But I started preaching about temptation and being overwhelmed and anxiety. And I just had all these feelings of anxiety come over me again. All this feeling of inadequacy again. And all this stuff welling up inside of me again. And finally I realized if I don't deal with this anxiety, it's going to lead to depression. And in August of 2015, I had that panic attack on stage. Started sweating. It was unreal. Things just weren't right. I started thinking, I got to go talk to my doctor. I talked to my wife. Talked to some other people. And I went to the doctor and he said, I think it's time that you need to get on an antidepressant. So in October of 2015, I took one. And he said, we're going to try this for about a year and see what happens. And let me just tell you, I've had people say, Randy, you can't tell people you're a pastor and you took an antidepressant. They're going to think that you don't have it all together. Well, since when did you presume that I had it all together? I never told you I had it all together. That's your own fault, making assumptions, right? I've had people tell me, well, Randy, you can't tell them you're on an antidepressant. They're going to think less of you. Well, I could give a rat's rear end what people think about me. You still can be all consumed about that. Oh, I'm worried about what this person thinks. Worried about that. I spent my whole life worried. That put me in depression. You want to put yourself in depression real quick? Worry about what everybody else thinks about you. That'll put you in depression really quickly. I said, I'm done with that. Can't worry about what they're thinking. I need to be focused on who I am, who God says that I am, and the mission that he's given me to help people meet, know, and follow Jesus. And if somebody's confused about who I am, negative about who I am or in opposition to who I am, I'm not going to get focused on them. I'll keep my eyes on my Savior. Otherwise, I'm going to start sinking like Peter did. And that's going to be even worse for me. So I need to keep my eyes focused. And here's what I can tell you. Since I've been taking an antidepressant, I'm a better follower of Christ. I'm a better husband. I'm a better father. I believe that I'm a better friend. I'm a better dad. God is healing me through medication. And listen, I don't care how God chooses to heal me. That's up to him. Whatever way he wants to heal me, I'm just glad that I got healing. Can I get an amen? Amen. That's all that matters to me. If the end goal is I feel terrible, but now I don't, praise God that I don't. I don't care what method he chooses. See, and people, they get all confused about this because, I just don't know. And, am I trusting God enough? I don't have enough faith. The brain, just like the liver, is an organ. And it's in your body. And if you would take a pill for your liver, but you wouldn't take a pill for your brain, that makes you a hypocrite. It makes no sense. If I said your liver's failing, if you take this pill, you'll be healed, would you take it? You go, yeah. It's the same exact thing. Same exact thing. Don't ever let anyone look down on you for what God is doing in you. He's just not doing it through the means that those people think that he should do it, but that's why he's God and they're not. Somebody give me an amen. That's a good thing. Let's keep reading. Verse 15. And the prayer that's offered in faith will make the sick person well. I want to stop real quick. And the Bible says that if you're sick, and that's all of us, if you're dealing with any of these things, you come forward, you let the people in the church know. You take medication if you need medication. Not everybody, by the way, needs medication. Okay, if the doctor prescribes it, then you need it. But to be clear, it's okay to take medication if you need medication. The Bible says that the prayer offered in faith will make that sick person well. And I want to be open and honest and say, that's not an instantaneous thing every time. Now, this is another church background thing that messed everybody up that I've got to clean up again. Man, I'm just doing cleanup today. At the end of the day, it's like if somebody doesn't get healed right here in this moment, well, then they either have a lack of faith or they didn't do something right or, it's their fault. No. No. That's not truth at all. I believe that the scripture is going to teach us that God begins his healing work the very second that we do these things. When we confess our sins to each other, when we come together and we get prayer, when we anoint one another with oil, when we do this prayer offered in faith, the Bible says it'll make the sick person well. It's a process, and it starts the moment that we do it, but it doesn't always happen instantaneously. Here's what God did. During my time and season of depression, here's what he did. He revealed to me my sin. That's what he did. Now, my story may not be your story, okay? But it's my story, and I'm up here today, and I get to share, so I'm going to share it, okay? One of the greatest gifts that God can give us is the revelation of our own sin. Because when he reveals it to us, we can actually bring it to the surface. We can confess it, get it out of our lives. And listen, that all didn't even happen for me in an instant. He said, this is an area I need you to work on, and we dealt with it. And he said, oh, by the way, this is an area we need to work on, and we dealt with it. Oh, by the way, don't forget that one. And you know what that really is? Let's modernize it. That's the equivalent of going to the doctor and saying, doctor, will you do an x-ray test on me? And he does the x-rays, and they come back, and he says, oh, by the way, you got a problem with your liver, or you got a problem with your pancreas, or you got a problem with X, Y, or Z. It's just the doctor coming and saying, here's what the issue is. Now we need to do something about it. When God reveals a sin to us, it's just him saying, hey, this is the area of your life that if you'll work on this, I can start a healing process in you. Now, here's what I did as a man, and I think a lot of people in the room, we do this. When I was going through all this season of terrible stuff and depression, and just all I could think about was if so-and-so didn't do that, then I would feel better. If that person would stop doing that, then everything would be good. If she would just treat me better, then this wouldn't be this way. All those thoughts kept creeping in. And you know what God taught me? He taught me that he wanted to do something in me. Jesus doesn't want to change your circumstance. He wants to change you through your circumstances. So if you're struggling with fear, anxiety, depression, suicidal thoughts, know that God's busy as the great physician working on you. And there's going to be times when it's very uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable. Now, this just came to my mind that I need to share with you. I didn't share this in the first service. Imagine if we walked into the room and we saw somebody with a scalpel in their hand and they've got a person laid out on a table and they're getting ready to cut them open and we didn't have any clue what they were doing. We'd be like, dude, stop, what are you doing? Like literally, back here, it doesn't happen here, but back here, like in a room, right? You're like, oh, you know, we don't got no Abraham Isaac stuff going on here. But at the end of the day, you know, you go and you see that, you'd be like, they're going to hurt that person. They're going to mess that person up. Until you learn that, wait a second, that person's a licensed doctor. They know what they're doing. And actually, they're doing a surgery on that person. And they're going to do something that looks extremely painful. And there's all this mess everywhere. But they're actually going to sew them back up. They're going to put them back together. And once they remove all that junk out of them, it's actually going to heal them and make them better. Well, when we have the context of what's actually happened, we go, oh, that's awesome. That makes sense. That's great. Now we're supportive of it. But at the end of the day, we just don't like the process of the surgery. We don't like that part of it. It's scary. We're not sure. And we also go, man, that could hurt. You know what? Surgery hurts sometimes. God leads us not around all that junk. What he wants to do is he wants us to lead through all that junk. And it's in the leading through all that mess that the biggest life change happens for all of us. That's where we find real freedom. James 5:16, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other. Ooh, wait a second, I gotta back up. This verse said, and I don't know if you caught it, it said, therefore confess your sins to each other. Wait a second, I don't know if you saw it. It said, therefore, in order to find healing, you got a problem, you're sick. If any among you is sick, this is what you need to do. He says, therefore, confess your sins to each other. Well, I couldn't do that. People are going to think things about me. Okay, well, the Bible says in James 5:16, therefore, confess your sins to each other. Well, somebody's going to think less of me. Not God. God's going to think you were obedient. What about that other? Well, since when do we worry about that other person? Therefore, confess your sins to each other. You know, a lot of people read this verse, and we read the rest of it. Every time we read, we always read the rest of the verse, and we just kind of skim over and we read. But I know that our church is stuck because we don't apply the rest of the verse. We never get to the application. We talk about it. You have heard it. Therefore, confess your sins to each other. That's where we stop right there. We're like, can't do that. No way. No way. Couldn't go there, Pastor. Sorry. Well, man, you just don't want healing then. It really is that black and white. It really is. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is say it with me, it's powerful and effective. One more time. It's powerful and effective. Revolution Church style. It's powerful and effective. That's powerful and effective. Let me tell you about powerful and effective. Okay, many years ago, I was a college student, 18 years old. I was working as a children's pastor at a church, and we had Sunday school, we had church service, we went out and ate together after church, we had like Sunday lunch together. Then we were Baptist, so we had Sunday night church, and then because we were Baptist, we had a pizza blast afterwards to celebrate one of our staff members who was going to be traveling away. And it was like over a Thanksgiving holiday, and so we got in the car after doing all that ministry and being up all day, and we were dog tired. Naomi and I, we get in the car, and we're going to drive back from Springfield, Missouri. We're going to take a long drive all through the night for 11 hours to get to Ohio, to go home. How many of y'all have ever done this before? You drive overnight, and you're super tired. And listen, I get in the car, and dude, I'm like, I'm so sleepy. Like, my head's doing the... You know, and it'll like, she's like, are you okay? Oh, yeah, I'm good. And I'm like dying over here, right? Like yeah, I'm good. And so I remember pulling over into a gas station very reluctantly, and I go in and I go to the little clerk back there, and nobody in there. And I said, hey, man, I said, dude, I'm tired, and I've got to go to Ohio right now. I know you don't even know where Ohio is on a map, but, bro, I need some help. I need to get to Ohio. It's 11 hours away, and I need to stay up all night. Can you help me? Do you know of anything I can buy here? And his face lit up. And I thought, oh, man. And he said, I've got something. He said, hold on just a second. He said, do you have like $14, $15? I said, yes. He goes, I'll be back. He went over and he got all this stuff, and I don't even know what all was in this drink, but I do know this. He's like 1.12 capacitor, some da-da-da-da, and then he keeps describing, and then the last thing I heard was, and 6 shots of espresso. And I said, all right, let's see what that'll do. So I paid for it. Oh, y'all crazy. Yeah, baby, we were college students, okay? So I grabbed that, and I remember I took a drink of that. What normally would be an 11-hour drive home, I made it home in 20 minutes, and I didn't even have a car, okay? Like, that stuff, all I can tell you is it was powerful, and it was effective. I don't even remember driving the whole night. I just know we got there quickly. Why do I say all that? Well, let's kind of bring this back to a spiritual level. There's some people that I absolutely want to pray over me. There's some people that when they pray, I just believe that God's hand of anointing is all over them. I believe they have the gift and the power of prayer. When they pray, it's powerful and effective. And you've seen these people just like I have. You know, you have certain people, hey man, will you pray for me? And listen, they say they're going to pray, but they don't pray for you. They don't pray for you. They ain't even thinking about you. You know, you're like, hey, thanks for praying for me 3 weeks ago. And they're looking at you deer in the headlights. They don't even remember you asking them to pray for you, right? But then there's other people that they don't even know all the details of what's going on with your life. You're just like, hey, I've got a health issue. Will you pray for me? And they start praying this prayer, and they speak to your exact issue that you're going through, and you never even told them about it. And the Spirit of God moves in their prayer, and you're just like, wow, their prayer is powerful and effective. And you just believe that God is present, and God is doing something, and he's about to change your life when they pray. Y'all have seen those people, amen? You've seen those people, and I've seen those people, and here's what I know. I believe that our prayer partners are anointed by God. I believe that when they pray, their prayers are powerful and effective. Are these people perfect people? No. I just believe that they have a gift of faith. I believe that some of them have a gift of prophecy to speak over a person's life and to speak truth to a person. And you know what? Sometimes that's a celebratory truth to say, hey, let me tell you what God's saying. And we smile at the end. And some of it's, hey, let me tell you this because you need to hear this and you're not going to be happy when you hear it. But you know what? We need people like that in our lives. You know who I call those people? They're the spotters. They're the spotters. They're the people in our life that when we go to them and we're struggling with too much weight and it's unbearable, we got fear, anxiety, suicidal thoughts, and depression, and we're sick, we ought to be able to go to a prayer partner and say, hey, let me tell you what I'm going through. And those people, I believe, are anointed of the Lord, and the Holy Spirit of God ministers through them, that it being a spiritual gift to minister to people and to let the Holy Spirit of God do a thing that you couldn't experience any other way. And the Scripture tells us, Scripture tells us that when we do this, that healing begins. Healing begins. Listen, I want to kind of go back to that whole day when I thought about that car, running that light and that car hitting me. I want you to listen to me. It's a dark place to be, but I didn't get through it by listening to a worship song. I didn't get through it by reading another Bible verse or listening to another message. That's not what got me through it. I remember I sat in a room, and I'll never forget, I called a guy, and I said, dude, I need you to meet me right now. It was late at night, and I called him. I said, hey, I need to meet right now. I need to talk about my life. And he met me, and I looked at him eye to eye, and I said, I want to kill myself. Then about 10 seconds later, I said, I don't want to. And I'm not going to tell you I never had a suicidal thought ever again, but I can tell you that in that very second of just saying it verbally out loud, that that's what was going on, the thoughts that were in my head, just simply speaking it out loud into the light, something changed where 10 seconds later, I immediately had this presence of, that's not what you want to do. And then because I had confessed that to somebody who was a good enough spotter. By the way, you need a spotter who can lift enough weight, okay? You don't get your, you know, like somebody so young in the faith that they can't lift the weight if you get in trouble. You need somebody mature in their faith, mature as a believer, to help spot you and lift that off you, okay? So don't just run to anybody. Run to a church person that's got some maturity behind them. That's what you need. But I confess that, and that person walked me through, and it, by the way, is still there in my corner to walk me through anything that I face. That was a period of time, a moment in time, pivotal for my life and the strengthening of this relationship. And I'm so glad that I did that day. Church, listen, it's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay that way. Here's the moment of truth. I'm going to ask our prayer partners to come forward. I'm going to ask our worship team to get in place. You know, first service, I watched a whole bunch of people who were struggling with fear, anxiety, depression, and suicidal thoughts. I watched them receive their healing. For some of them, I watched a lot of tears flow down a lot of people's face. By the way, in this message, the whole time I've been up here, there's been people crying all throughout this room today. All over the place. It's been hard to preach this message. It's been one of the hardest messages to preach is a message just like this. But I believe that God loves you so much that you just need to know that you're not alone in those feelings. And that an enemy does want to take you out. An enemy does want to destroy you and keep you trapped in that prison cell. And here's what I know about these prayer partners. They're not perfect. But somebody this week, I believe with all my heart, somebody, you wrote your suicide note. That's where you're at. You're right there. And you were saying, God, if you're just real, just give me a sign. Show me something that says that I'm not supposed to do this. And if you ask any one of these prayer partners right now, if they're willing to be a spotter for you, I guarantee you all of them will shake their head yes. Because that's who they are. They're not perfect, but they love people. And they want what God wants. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet right now. If anyone is among you is sick, let them share it with somebody in the church. Let them have the laying on of hands and be anointed with oil. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. I'm going to ask you to meet me right up front here. I'm going to be standing right here. The worship team is going to lead us through a song. Let the words of the song penetrate your heart. One of my favorite songs talks about how, you know, man, I thought that God would have come through by now, that these issues and these problems I've been dealing with would have been taken care of already, but they're not. So now what? A couple things you can do. In your seat, worship the Lord. If you're good today, worship Him the best you can. If you're not good today, you're suffering with fear, anxiety, depression, suicidal thoughts, man, come up here. Let's connect you to a prayer partner. Let's start that healing process right now. I don't know why anybody would choose to stay stuck. It makes no sense. Let God minister to your heart. Get out of your seat. Make a bold move. Stop worrying about people around you and what they think. That's what's leading you to all this mess. Come find healing. Get your spotter on your team to spiritually help guide you to the next phase of your life. I love you, church, and I want what's best. Let's make our way forward.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the faithfulness, your faithfulness.
not too late for you to come. We're never full. You come if you need help. There's no reason to stay stuck, church. Love each other too much for that. Church, I've watched a lot of things happen today. I watched watched a lot of good things happen today. The people all in the back praying. I don't know if you see them or not. The people back there. We needed that today, church. We needed that. And you know what? It'd be a lot easier to come up here and preach a lot of sugarcoating messages that tickle people's ears, that make people just smile and be happy. But here's what I found. That doesn't really transform anybody. It doesn't really change anything. People come and people leave and that's it. Here's what I found. When people who don't even know each other do what God says, do you understand how powerful and effective it is? Watch people who just flat out needed a hug this morning. And that put them to tears because they felt alone for too long. Church, we're starting to get it. And that's exciting to me. Because when we obey the scriptures and when we do these things, guys, I'm telling you, it transforms our life. And it's what I've experienced personally. It's what I want for you. We're all in this together. So we might as well stop attacking each other, looking around and seeing what's wrong with everybody. And we might as well unite arms and lock hands together and say, guys, we're in this together. We might as well get there. I need you to know, heaven's going to look a lot different than you might picture it. There'll be black people there, white people there, Mexican people there, my Latinos in the house. Yeah, we're all going to be there. Everybody. I mean, every nationality will be represented. Guess what? People that made a lot of money are going to be there. People that didn't have anything are going to be there. Democrats are going to be there. Wait a second. Republicans are going to be there. You're going to be surprised when you get to heaven. You might as well just get good at loving each other here on this earth. And make the world a lot better of a place if we could figure it out. Next week, man, we always do this. We get to these moments where we have this, really impactful thing. And then I set it up like this. Next week, we're going to talk about bitterness and unforgiveness. And I really think it's going to be one of those areas of life that'll free a lot of people. You may not be struggling with anxiety and depression today. And if that's not the case, praise God for that. But there are some people here that, man, you're tore up with bitterness. And it's transformed who you used to be. And you're no longer doing what God wanted for you to do because you've got some unforgiveness in your heart. That could be something that's happened to you. Quite honestly, you maybe need to ask for forgiveness from somebody. We're going to talk about it next week. So if you want to get hammered on some stuff and you want to hear what God has to say about it, we're going to open up the good book. And we're going to see what God does through it. But here's what happens. Can you imagine what happens when we go deep like this? We opened up three verses today, and we got people in tears and getting healing. And we got ministry happening. Life change taking place. It's amazing. Three verses. God's word is powerful. It's living. It's active. The Bible says it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to a man and a woman's heart to figure out what the motives of a person are. And it has the power to change us. And I'm telling you, we get to do this all over again in 7 days. And if you're in a group, you get to be doing it even more frequently than that. So I hope you guys are in your word. I can't wait to see you guys next week. I want to thank everybody for joining the 90-day challenge. Everybody that's joined, God's going to honor that. I told you last week, try it for 90 days, see what God does. Give to him faithfully and watch what he'll do. And I'm telling you, a lot of you guys stepped into that area and said, hey, I'm gonna take a step here. I'm going to take a step of faith. I'm going to trust God. And I just can't wait to hear the stories of just miracles that take place as a result of that obedience. I know it will happen. You stay strong in it, stay faithful, and let's watch what God will do. I'll see you guys next week.